All I, this is an easy thing to do, since all I have to do is gather insights from you guys and I'll have the whole thing wrapped up. Right? So what do you make of the dream? And how shall we analyze it? It's the second part that's interesting. How shall we analyze it? Go ahead.
Meaningfully. It's, I think we got to deal with, right, the similarities and the differences between the instruction given to the dream, how it's told to Agamemnon, what is added in terms of extra dream comments, I'm going to call them. Right, like the dream speaking to Agamemnon about why is that he's sleeping or what king should be doing on the eve of battle. It's an extra dream comment. And that's pretty interesting. Like, why is it that the dream hasn't been told to do that, but he does it? I'm not saying that's a complete answer to your question. But
well, then let's skip it and go on.
I found one difference.
Uh-oh.
Only one difference between, if we look at what Zeus tells the dream and what the dream tells Agamemnon, I found only two words of a difference in that. So that at least seems faithful as far as there being communication from the gods or from Zeus. There's no interpretation going on except for that one addition. Which is the from Zeus part on line 133. Yeah, it says, and over the Trojan hang woes by the will of Zeus. The original doesn't have this whole by the will of Zeus business, that the woes have come by the will of Zeus. That's an interpretation if we're just looking at the text itself on the dream's part, not Agamemnon's, of what Agamemnon had told him to do. Otherwise, I found that the words totally match up to even to the point of like being in the exact form but modified for Agamemnon. The tenses of the verbs, for instance.
Therefore, we can say that given Zeus' dream, it was distorted in the following way.
By the will of Zeus.
Pardon?
With the addition, by the will of Zeus, that the Trojans hang woes, and over the Trojan hang woes by the will of Zeus.
And you said there were two?
No, that it was just, it's two words, ek dios, so. Translated as.
Yeah. Jonathan.
I was curious, why would the Dream Master add so much more than what Agamemnon, or than what Zeus told the dream to say? He added all kinds of things.
That's right. Come on, listen.
Well, he takes the form of Nestor.
So look at him. So he added. What he added? Go ahead.
He takes the shape of Nestor, and then he says, "You are asleep, lord of many horses. No master mine ought to sleep the whole night long. When his cares are so many and his nations are in charge, I'm a messenger from Zeus who far away cares for you and pities you. He bids you arm the Phaeacians with all haste. For now you may take the city of Troy." That's from Zeus. And then the part about the Olympians is from Zeus.
Would you say then that is what Agamemnon receives as a consequence?
Yeah.
Okay. And what about Nestor's response to it?
That if it came to anyone else, he would have just said disregard it, right? But if it came from Agamemnon.
It came from anyone else?
He would have.
Right. So therefore, in principle, he rejects the dream, except that it happens to come from the commander or the king Agamemnon. Wow. Yeah. Which is splendid, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Especially given what Homer says. Yeah.
Well, especially
right?
Given what a jerk Agamemnon is throughout every portrayal we get of him.
But no, but look at this language on 35 through 40. So spake the dream and departed, and left him there, pondering in his heart, that is, left Agamemnon there, pondering in his heart on things that were not to be brought to pass. For, in sooth, he deemed that he should take the city of Priam that very day, fool that he was. Indicating to us, he's drawn a conclusion from the dream that is... Okay. Makes him a fool, I mean, according to Homer himself.
Is the image of Hera change from one to the other? In this transmission, does the image and what is said about Hera change?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean... I wish I was better off than Hera in the first book, but the idea that Hera has bent all the... I mean, aren't the gods still divided? Like, it's a lie, isn't it?
I just want to know whether there's any difference between the way the dream is presented to Agamemnon and the original statement in the dream.
Okay, gotcha.
In the given dream, Hera is allied with Zeus, because... Mm-hmm. Evils are in store for the Trojans from Zeus. So Hera is allied, but Zeus just says evils are in store for the Trojans. There's no connection with
him. And when it gets there?
Hera and Zeus are allies.
No, but I think Pierre was referring to how Agamemnon gives the dream, relates the dream and the dream's meaning to the rest of the Achaeans, right?
He asked about Hera's role.
Hera.
Right. Yes. In respect to the third telling of the dream, though, right?
Oh, I didn't hear that. Disregarding the second telling of the dream. There is a difference, he pointed out right there.
Right
there.
Yeah, that's right.
But he was showing that he built on your idea, Nebuya did, by saying that this shows that there are an alliance in the telling of the dream.
No, absolutely.
Yeah. Try your translation, okay?
I didn't miss that.
I read about a line just before the chat. Sinister dream. Go down amid the fast ships of Achaea. Enter Lord Agamemnon's quarters. Tell him everything, point by point, as I command you. Let him prepare the long-haired carls of Achaea to fight at once. Now we may take by storm the spacious town of Troy. The Olympians, tell them, are of two minds no longer. Hera swayed them, and black days overhang the men of Troy. Next paragraph after that. The Olympian gods are of two minds no longer. Hera, pleading, swayed them all. Mm-hmm. And bitter days from Zeus await the Trojans. Same or?
Different.
Is that any?
Well, in your translation, they changed it to pleading. But in mine, it's both Hera forced. In both.
That's what I said.
Hera forced?
Yeah, Hera forced them all over.
It also says from Zeus. The second one says from Zeus. The first one doesn't indicate that.
Okay. As Agamemnon then repeats the dream, right at about 60, what do you see? All right, now we want to make a contrast, don't we?
Must be right, then.
Well, that would strengthen his case.
Yeah, Nestor's the wise man.
Especially if you're trying to convince Nestor.
But I thought the sinister dream added Nestor.
That's true.
No, but the at least in my translation, it says Nestor, he's exactly like Nestor in looks and voice, whereas
he added one part.
One part, right, the voice.
That's
part.
Okay. I didn't add the whole of Nestor. That
yeah,
was
no, you're not.
Okay.
Form and stature and building. But yeah, what does Pierre mean by added? Right? Like, right? Given the content, is describing the messenger, how he looks, pertinent to the content?
Are you talking about the description of Nestor?
Yeah, I'm wondering, what do you mean by
Agamemnon adding? Was there any figure in the original statement to Agamemnon that suggested anyone was playing the role of Nestor as Agamemnon reports it?
Well, it said the dream leaned over his head in the shape of Nestor, but it doesn't say he was exactly like Nestor in looks and voice. That's my translation, so that's a stronger identification that he's giving with Nestor than what the dream itself gives.
Mm-hmm. See, there's still an addition, but it's a different addition. Mm-hmm. In the Fitzgerald, it says, a figure in height and bearing, very close to Nestor. It doesn't give voice.
Yeah, bearing?
Bearing, and it doesn't give, I don't... And in the lobe it says in form and in stature and in build. Again, no voice.
You have no voice, yeah. That's what I was wondering.
But that's still form and stature and build is still adding. Right?
Still adding.
He's making it tighter, right. Stronger.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And giving it more authority with the stature on here.
Ooh, yeah. I'm willing to see that Agamemnon is doing something deceitful, but I mean, isn't this?
I don't think
couldn't he be? This is what I'm trying to say. Couldn't he be being honest to how he saw the dream, right? Like,
yeah.
How he saw Nestor in the dream.
Yeah, but it's still different in how it's described as an appearance to him.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? So it could be an honest mistake, but it could still be an interpretive problem.
See, why would it be a mistake?
Yeah, that's what we need. Watch, look here. We're getting pretty good. We're dealing with one word. One idea, adding, are we not?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Hi, by the way, does Zeus add anything? So in general, you can say, are they all adding? And what difference does the adding make?
Yeah, what do you mean Zeus adding? It's his dream. What do you mean it's his... How can Zeus add something? It's his dream. How can Zeus add something? It's his dream.
He's a source.
That's true. What does that? What does Zeus add?
The dream.
The whole thing is the
kid. Well, the idea of the...
Look here. I didn't mention it. Too. What does Zeus add as he designs the dream? What does he add?
It's his And Zeus cares for him.
That's true. Okay, that's it.
The victory of the,
okay.
of the Trojans.
Can't
get
anything more. Can't get anything
more. The victory of the Achaeans.
What?
The victory of the Achaeans.
Okay.
Well, I think that
victory.
That the gods are at peace. They're not arguing about the matter anymore.
Okay.
See that gets back to what it is.
Yeah, it's Nestor, but he clearly says that it's Nestor's likeness, stating I am the messenger of Zeus. Not Nestor, but they likeness.
The relationship between book one and book two.
Yeah, but I want hey, look here. How did this dream come into existence?
He's got a problem.
Is there not a goal for the dream?
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. What's the goal for the dream? According to Zeus.
He was pondering in his heart how he might do honor to Achilles and lay many low beside the ships of the Achaeans.
Yeah, do it again.
He was pondering in his heart how he might do honor to Achilles and lay many low beside the ships of the Achaeans. Two goals.
By the way, how did he ever get the idea of giving Agamemnon a dream?
He promises to trick him.
Because of what?
You gotta speak up.
He promises to trick him.
He promises to trick him.
No. That's not my question.
It says he thought it best, but I don't...
He pondered all night.
He pondered all night to achieve a certain goal.
That's right.
And he used a dream to do it.
Yes.
What assignment did he get? And from whom?
Is it from Thetis?
From Thetis, thank you. Yeah. What did she ask? Did he add something to Thetis's original statement? Yes or no?
Yeah, he wanted to cover Achilles with glory.
Whoever's got the page number.
Give me the goal, Thetis.
It's, well, I think it's line 5.
505.
Lend the Trojans power until the Achaeans recompense my son and heap new honor upon him.
Thank you. What are the two?
Lend the Trojans power until the Achaeans recompense my son and heap new honor upon him.
Thank you. What's the difference?
Well, destroying the Achaeans at the ships is one, isn't it?
You got the quotes. Take a look.
The magnifying him with honor versus covering him with glory, at least in my translation.
Yes. What's the contrast? Then I know whether you're honored or not.
There's a bunch of cons. There's a bunch of differences.
That's right. There's a difference between honor and glory.
John,
Dishonor Agamemnon.
I have the Ralph, but Thetis says, satisfy my son, Zeus Olympian most wise, let the Trojans prevail until the Achaean nation shall satisfy my son and magnify him with honor.
Oh, yeah. So he leaves stuff out?
I just now give me a conclusion.
Satisfy my son.
What? Look here, we're talking about goals. Right? Thetis has a goal. To achieve her goal, she sets out two conditions that must be met. Right?
Okay.
Zeus has a goal. Does he add anything to it? If you don't fix in your mind what Thetis is saying, when you read what Zeus says, you won't see it unless you keep it in mind.
So I would say the difference is Thetis wants the Achaeans to honor him. But Zeus, he's going to honor him.
Right. So he is certainly adding
all the power that he has.
That's right. And that's why the term of exalted is probably better than honor, but that's okay.
Canadation is outside of that.
Interesting.
Depending upon whether it becomes a religious or spiritual thing, whether it's honor or exalted. Okay, that's a translation problem. Okay. Would you say then that Zeus added, yes or no?
Yeah, he changed.
Well, just on that last point, as far as honor or exalt is concerned, it's the same word in the Greek. So if we're going to plug the idea that it's exalt, it's because the honor comes from Zeus, right?
I don't mind. We just see. We have to see what kind of honor he's going to bequeath him, and later we'll decide which word is better to be used.
Okay, but just to be clear, in the Greek, it's the same word.
It doesn't make any difference.
It's the same word, Tim.
But it doesn't make any difference if you add a level of meaning to the word.
Yeah. Ingmar, does it, even though it's the same word, does it say specifically that the Achaean nations are going to be doing the honoring versus just Zeus doing it?
And in the
that's
Greek.
Well, because in my quote it does.
It's in the Greek.
And,
okay, and that's the difference.
Yeah, and we would expect a different kind of honoring
from
one over the
right.
Other.
Yeah.
But we will have to see that unfold in the story. Now look, okay, one more step, another step, now look here. What must Zeus have in his mind in order to pull off this dream? So he pondered all night long. Why? On the face of it, it's absurd. Nestor says, hey, anyone else had that dream, we'd throw it out. It's only because it came to Agamemnon that he'll even give it the slightest attention. Hey, unless we go back to book one and see the role Nestor is playing and describe how he is functioning in book one, we'll miss it. Next, in that dream, you do not agree, the role of Hera changes, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Same? Different. What's the difference between the two? Remember, we
went
over
the show. You mean from her role in book one, you mean?
In the way in which it's expressed in the two statements.
Yeah, depending on the translation.
That I don't see.
Depending on the translation.
Depending upon
force and plead or...
Yeah, and therefore we go to the Greek quickly to see whether or not it justifies one or the other. Okay, look here. In order to make sense of this story, we have to go back and see how he describes Hera in book one. Same thing with Nestor.
Yes.
Otherwise, we won't appreciate Nestor's remark. Okay, let me put it another way. As you consider the way Hera is described in the dream, what picture do you get of her and her ability?
Persuasive, strong enough. Persuasive.
Persuasive.
Enough to
over all the gods.
Over all the gods.
Right.
Who are partisan, extremely partisan.
That's right. Right. So now we have to keep that in mind and take a look at the way she's described in book one to see whether or not we can even imagine her having that ability.
Nagging is
right?
The way she's described in book one.
Yeah.
Nagging.
If you go and build this up, you'll now have a picture of her, won't you?
Yes.
Now the question is, you see, in terms of this story, then Zeus is looking, right, it's crafting the dream. Would you not agree he knows Agamemnon? Therefore, would you not agree we have a whole bunch of qualities of him that we've been developing? Given his psychological profile, given hers, and his goal from Thetis, he raises the whole argument, the whole problem of Achilles to a much higher and more profound level.
Who does?
Zeus. he's no longer concerned in allowing the Achaeans to give and heap honor upon Achilles. He is trying to bestow the honor. Therefore, he's raising the drama.
Interesting.
Right? So, okay. Got a picture? See the work we need? Why? So then you can sit back and say, hey, I can see why Nestor would say what he would say. That fits his personality in book one. Hey, I can see why Zeus would frame a dream, given Agamemnon's state of mind, knowing that his chief attendant is Nestor. Well, he knows what assignment he got from Thetis. Is he just going to be a messenger boy?
Yeah, no.
Or is he going to raise the whole game on a higher level?
Zeus the
Why?
Messenger boy.
Because the book, the whole book is devoted to one thing. First paragraph. What do we have to see? The will of Zeus.
Was accomplished.
Right?
Brought to fulfillment.
So look here. You should see the first flash of the will of Zeus in the dream, given this background. Then, must he not know then the psychological dispositions of all of these people? The tensions they live in? Their background? Crafty dude.
Yeah,
crafty.
Right? Now, if we can go from there, now we can see that there are two strategists in this great story. Agamemnon, strategist. Achilles, of course. But the other one, Odysseus, Ulysses.
Described as Zeus's peer in warcraft.
Right? So we want to look at that next, don't we? But let's make sure. Are we together?
We're together, but.
Well, this is, yeah. We're together that this is not done yet. We need to do this, right? So are we going to work on that now?
Or? I don't know.
Or shall we read through book two?
Well,
get the Odysseus? I'm eager for the future.
Oh, I kind of would like to see that. Yeah. Before we go further.
We got a boat.
I'm game.
You're game to go forward or back?
To go with you.
With the, on board with you.
Go for the detailed understanding of book one. So we can understand the dream.
To be led to the truth.
It's pretty obvious that Nestor's very impressed by this whole Scepter deal, right?
Scepter?
Scepter. Scepter.
Oh,
Scepter.
Yeah.
Scepter. Yeah. Scepter. He's very impressed by that.
Scepter.
That Agamemnon is in that tradition.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have the. What does Agamemnon do now that he's got that training? Now we can play the next level. Mm-hmm. Right. I'm at around 100, book two. He bumps it, doesn't he, in terms of the gods. Turns to his men, right? Gathers them all together. friends, fighters, Danians, companions of Ares. The son of Cronos has entangled me in cruel folly, wayward god. He promised solemnly that I should not sail before I stormed the inner town of Troy. Crookedness, duplicity, it's clear. He calls me to return to Argos beaten after these many losses. I mean, he certainly reflects on the dream.
No.
He makes one up.
He calls it testing them, right?
Yeah, this is called testing them out.
But they all fail.
Yeah.
Right, okay, so the first address to the multitude is the elders. This one's to the men. Mm-hmm.
They call it a custom to do that, right? To test the men.
Where are you at with that? I'm embarrassed to ask.
You know, I was reading in this translation, but line 70, maybe. Mm. Let me test them first in that harangue that custom calls for.
Mm.
Of course, it's not clear whether it's a test or harangue.
Test or what?
Or harangue is the custom.
Testing, Pirado.
Now we have to play between Agamemnon and Odysseus, don't we? And that great kind of comic figure that runs in here that helps us out a great deal.
Oh,
the rest of the
Oresteus, yes. Right? Yeah. Favorite.
Do we have another seer at work in Odysseus in book two?
Hmm.
Book one starts with seers. Book two got seers.
The peer of Zeus in council.
We want to see every example in the book of seeing, foreseeing, prophesizing, visualizing the future in any way.
Mm.
The book is loaded. It's a clash between seeing. Right, we have comic relief with the rest of these. But that allows the Homer to put in the hands of what is often regarded as a local clown the very words anyone else would be killed by.
Hmm.
Doesn't.
Right.
If anyone else said it, they'd be dead.
Well, yeah, right. This guy said to it.
He's a clown.
Clowns
have the ability to speak the truth with impunity. Up to a certain
point.
Right? Here we have the great role, the clown in every kingdom.
The court jester. What's that?
The word for counsel, magus, I'm thinking that is the grandfather of, or the father of Plenty, Porus, in the Symposium. Never at a loss, translated, never at a loss. I think so.
I haven't looked at that.
They translated here, you know, counsel in one of the books as this translation.
And it's always associated with Zeus.
Is it Metis?
Metieta Zeus in Theogony. He's called that numerous times.
That maybe that's why he's considered his peer in that regard, yes. That aspect.
That's big time. My word.
Yeah.
Not that I know how it became that way, but it does remind me of Montana.
That's what?
Just Montana.
Montana. Learned by inquiry.
Oh yeah, and Mulo too, right? With the mysteries.
There were many who gathered against the Trojans.
That's fair, but I need a little more. What can you learn?
Did we say they were outnumbered? We have to know the population.
I haven't looked at it recently, but do we learn about the differences between the Greeks?
I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
How about
the degree of force that they were
trying?
The degree of force that they were trying to use?
That's true. I go for that. Yeah. Anything else? Okay.
How that is strength and power.
No, okay.
What do you got, Pierre?
Yeah. Come on.
Get in.
There was a light cause amongst the multitude that went against him.
There's a specific number of ships.
The sea shine. Hey, look at that. This is the will of Zeus. Is it just to show a war with the Achaeans and the Trojans? Is that the goal?
Yeah. No. No. It's not the subject of the work.
But what?
We want to see the higher meaning for...
That's true, Bill.
Like, Pierre, I counted 1,176 ships.
Pardon?
Yeah, I counted 1,176 ships.
Okay.
That's what I counted.
How many men on each ship?
That's difficult to say.
150 in certain descriptions.
In certain descriptions.
You can add them up.
Some are 50, and some just say many soldiers. Not very clear.
You can come up with a number. Okay, let's assume now we got the number and the ships. Anything else? So what? I mean, yes, that's worthwhile.
Yeah.
Well,
we got to see that number and think about it.
Okay, go ahead.
The Trojans have far less men. The Trojans have far less men, if you know it.
Could we read it and then try to answer?
Yeah, go ahead.
Where does it start?
Why should I tell you? You got the text.
Because I'm a bad student. They want to get there quicker.
If you take all the Achaeans and break them into groups of 10, and take all the people from Troy and make them one person, a wine steward for each group of 10, you'll have many groups of 10 Achaeans without a wine steward.
Oh boy, this is huge. and it tells little stories too. Okay, I got it. Line 484. Book 2. Tell me now, ye muses, that have dwellings on Olympus, for ye are goddesses and are at hand and know all things, whereas we hear but a rumor and know not anything. Who were the captains of the Danaans and their lords? But the common folk I could not tell nor name, nay, not though 10 tongues were mine and 10 mouths, and a voice unwearying, and though the heart within me were of bronze. Did not the Muses of Olympus, daughters of Zeus that beareth the Aegis, call to my mind all them that came beneath Ilios? Now I will tell the captains of the ships, and the ships in their order. Of the Boeotians, Peneleus and Latus were captains, and Arcesilaus and Prothoenor and Clonius. These were they that dwelt in Hyria, and rocky Olus, and Schoenus, and Scolus, and Etionus with its many ridges, Thespeia, Graia, and spacious Mucalesis, and that dwelt about Harma and Elysium, and Erythrae, and that held Eleon, and Hule, and Peteon, Ocalea, and Medeon, the well-built citadel, Copai, Eutressus, and Thisbe, the haunt of doves, that dwelt in Coronea and grassy Haliartus, and that held Plataea and dwelt in Glesus, that held lower Thebe, the well-built citadel, and holy Onchestus, the bright grove of Poseidon, and that held Arne, rich in vines, and Mudea, and sacred Nysa, and in Anthedon on the seaboard. Of these there came 50 ships, and on board of each went young men of the Boeotians, and 120. Gosh. And they that dwelt in Asplidon.
I know. That's a hell of a big ship, let me tell you. It's not small.
Those names.
And each ship, several things are going on.
Yep.
Would you agree we get the source of each one? Mm-hmm. Of all of the ships come from certain areas. Wouldn't it be interesting now to have a map? And we can identify where every one of these men come from who board these ships. So we'd have a map, wouldn't we? Next. Is there any mention of any of the gods?
Yes.
Influencing these men on their ships?
Yeah, there's...
And
there's
what effect did they have?
There's half mortal, half gods as captains on some of the ships.
So strong an influence that they forget their homelands and everything else. They forget the beautiful ships they're on and all they want to do is go to war. That's pretty powerful.
Yeah.
The gods are whipping them up. No. We want to know the role of the gods because we want to know what is the relationship between these gods and Zeus.
Yeah.
So now you're going to make a map, aren't you? To see the way in which they describe the ships, aren't they? On some of the beautiful descriptions?
Mm-hmm.
One of the descriptions, by the way, which I enjoyed in Homer, that he said that every day the ship came from one of these lands with nothing but wine. That was one hell of a ship, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Every day they could count on one ship coming from these lands for nothing but wine.
One per?
One ship, loaded with wine every day.
It's more clear. It's more clear how they could have a 9-year war.
Well, that's why they could have a 9-year war. Okay, Licker, what are you going to do? You're going to make a map, aren't you? You're going to describe the map and the role of the gods and each one of these flotillas.
Here, I took all the ships and averaged 50 men per ship. You got 48,000 men there.
Yeah. What's the significance of that?
Just, and then, you know, there are a lot of ships that have 150 men or more than that. You got a huge, you got a town there. That's the thing.
That's what we're looking for. See, we're looking for an number. Looking for total number of ships.
When they say that those men move like a field of grain waving in the wind, that's what
some people. Some people count 48, some people go up to 60,000. You make your own number. And see how you came to it. But most important, what's the role of the gods in each one of these flotillas?
Yeah.
Also, if it is that, if there are that many men, and 60 to 100,000 or however, then the will of Zeus takes on a much more dramatic role. Because I was seeing that Agamemnon is ruling over 60,000 men, but then Zeus's will is taking on both the Trojans and the Achaeans, which means that he's. It almost seems like.
I hope so.
Well, I'm thinking that I.
That's right.
Did Agamemnon at any time? Show disfavor towards Zeus or any of the gods.
So, after a while, that's okay.
Because
I didn't get your question.
Agamemnon dishonored the priest of Apollo in the first book.
Yes.
I
think that helps
everyone. I like that. Say it again.
Agamemnon, son of Atreus, dishonored the priest of Apollo. Crisis.
Oh, yeah. Good point. Measure.
That was Apollo. But what about Zeus?
Tell him, that's Apollo.
What about Zeus?
Apollo is Zeus' son.
But what about Zeus?
If you dishonored my son, I might not like it.
Yeah. That's not clear, Regina.
Well, I'm wondering if it looked like there's a relationship between Agamemnon and Zeus is what I'm thinking, that as Zeus is to the gods and the mortals, so too Agamemnon is to his men, and he does it in terms of the dream, because Zeus sends down a dream that turns into be false and Agamemnon, to persuade his men, tells them or tests them by giving them the opposite kind of image that they are that the dream said we're going to take home.
Okay, there are several distinctions. After Agamemnon receives this dream, does he communicate that to his troops?
Yes.
Or to his inner circle?
Inner circle.
His inner circle.
Oh. Then he makes up a dream for the men.
Right.
By the way, does it fit Agamemnon's personality profile in book one that he would be such a person as to do that?
Oh, I see. Oh, yeah. Okay.
That's what we're after. So, how much depth, how much credibility can we give to this story in terms of the interrelationships of the personality types at work playing out the particular roles in this drama under the overall image of the will of Zeus? And while doing that, how does he then relate to the gods?
How does Agamemnon relate to the gods?
How does Zeus relate to the gods?
Oh, how does Zeus relate? Oh.
I'd like to see the Facebook page jump in this week with answers.
Perhaps into reaching his goal.
What's that?
I said perhaps into reaching his goal, he relates to the gods, creating force to power. Relating to his goal, which is the ultimate dream from the beginning, right? That his goal with this was the dream, you know? So it's relating to the gods of what he's trying to interpret out of the dream, you know?
Yes, we would have to say that he had to be wise enough to understand who's getting the dream and what they're going to do with it, and that has to be consistent with the way in which they're described. So, Licker, would you agree that the conclusion to this catalog of ships and men and gods ends at approximately 800? Or 780, wherever you want to go? Whole description then of the horses, the steeds of war. Now we're at the dates, Priam. Iris then spoke to Priam.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Tall, with helmet flashing, Hector, great son of Priam, led the Trojans, largest of those divisions and the best, who drew up now armed, hefted spears. See now the role of the gods on the side of the Trojans.
Yep.
Alright. We want to know what ones? Agamemnon and the Trojans. We want all the gods. We want to see what role they're playing in this combo. Because so far, no one knows the will of Zeus and what he's planning. Though Hera has a suspicion. Thank you. your gods. Then there's a war among men and a war in the heavens. Therefore, the will of Zeus has two bundles. And through it all, we're going to see the will of Zeus on those two levels. There's a religious war in the heaven, an earthly war among men, and the interpenetration of the one with the other.
Which describes the war, you think?
Right. Until Apollo wakes up and says, you know what, from now on, we better not deal with the affairs of men. Okay. Okay. That's a good thing. I'm running out of it. Okay?
Fast. Right.